Humans of Mittigaram, and today we have with us a very special guest, Shruti Swaroop. She is a certified coach, a mentor, a speaker, and someone who has guided a lot of MNCs, PSUs, and telecom majors. But most importantly for me, she is a very down-to-earth woman, very humble, and very warm. Welcome to the podcast, ma'am. I'm hoping that you're having a good day and very excited to start my day with such positive vibes. So how are you feeling today?
Thank you for having me here, Deepti. It is really nice that Mittigaram decided to reach out. It is wonderful to speak to you. Thank you so much.
As you are aware, ma'am, that we are like our main aim is to promote female entrepreneurs, and you are someone who's always looking out and who's conducting mentorships and workshops for the same. So I believe that it was natural that we reached out to you. So I would like to start by, like, what are you doing this lockdown? Like, what are the productive things that are going in your life?
Interestingly, lockdown has been, as traumatizing it has been for everybody. For coaches like us, it is also a time where we really get to give back to the society. As mentors, as coaches, as people with experience, because this is the time people need help. This is the time people are really looking for someone to hold their hand and guide them, help them with stress, help them with just scheduling the day. So yeah, there's productivity is possibly at its highest because we see people need support. So that's what I've been busy with in the last 6 months now. And yeah, which seems to go on endlessly now.
So they do say that you, like, the person who's there for everyone also needs someone. So who would you say was there, like, in your life? Like, is it your husband, your father, your mother, or your children? Anyone can be a motivation source.
I think at various points in time, various people have been a motivator. When I was growing up, my father, I think he's the one who never raised, we are two sisters. He never raised us as a daughter. He was always like, you know, go for it, do whatever. And he was in the forces. So I come from an army background and he would take us with him and, you know, those morning walks and ensure that we're doing the Burma bridges and the jumps and everything at a very young age. So I was very, very tomboyish. I think somewhere I still am. So thereafter, I think it was my husband for a very long time. About 2 years back, there's another gentleman I met who's unfortunately just passed away 48 hours back. Not even that. I think he's been a fantastic mentor. So yeah, there are various people who've been mentors, guides. And obviously the children are there. I have two boys. And one of the things they keep telling me, they love Googling me on the net. And they find it very interesting to tell their friends that Mom is on the net. So I think that is a huge motivator because you see your kids looking at you with a lot of inspiration. And I think that's what I'd like them to take with them. That, yeah, I think it's far more difficult to raise boys in today's world. So if I can leave a good message for them, that is all I want.
Okay, that's really nice. I would believe that that's a very proud moment for them to show to their friends that, yeah, that's my mom. So I've seen a few friends of mine do that. Like, they are like, you know my mother's name, you should Google her and you will find a lot of things about her and all that. So that's quite a pride moment there. So since we have the topic of mindset, so I wanted to ask, like, what are the different mindsets and how will you know what type of mindset do you have? Like, can you get to know what type of a mindset a person has just by having a conversation with them?
Yes, you can get to know the mindset of a person by having a conversation. See, when you read papers and research papers and when you Google, you'll find a lot of things like positive mindset, growth mindset, fixed mindset, abundance mindset. So I think the names are quite a few. There is something like a justified mindset. So I think we can give whatever names we want to, but the point is that when you have a conversation with someone and the person is forever saying that, you know, I'm doing everything, but there's been no change in my life, which I think we keep hearing from a lot of people. I seem to be stuck here. What do I do differently? I have no choice. I think that is a clear sign of being in a mindset which is limiting you. a mindset where you're not exploring your possibilities. And I won't like to give it any adjective or any word. I would say that is a mindset that will not let you move on, grow. It is not good for you, for any one of us. The right kind of mindset would be where we start looking at, we are able to recognize opportunities. You know, if we are stuck at home, we are able to recognize that opportunity that, yes, for 6 months or a year, now I'm stuck at home. What can I do differently in this period? How can I give back to the world, to the society? If life has put me in a situation that, say, for example, the last 5 years, I'm stuck in the same job, nothing much is happening, no promotions, just a basic increment. What is it that you can do differently? When you start looking at those opportunities, when you start finding, trying different things, you know, this person is in the right frame of mind, this person will grow. And as long as we are, you know, as they say, as long as you're trying, you're not failing. So a person who's constantly trying is in the right mindset. You can call it positive mindset. You can call it growth mindset. You can call it abundance mindset. I think a successful person will always find opportunities wherever they are. A successful person will always, or a happy person will always be able to look at far more than what is out there in front of him. Sometimes, you know, be like, you know, I've been trying so many things and I still get the same results. And I'm like, you cannot try the same thing again and again and expect a different result, which means you need to do something differently.
Yeah, and I think, like Einstein said, that trying the same thing, you'll get the same results. It's sort of like insanity.
Absolutely. So a person with a good, successful growth mindset will look at opportunities, will find different ways, will continuously keep trying, will know that, okay, I am possibly, you know, trying to knock at the wrong door. Let me try a different door. So yeah, it's easy. You speak to a person. The other day I was speaking to somebody, I think the lady said, can't, don't, shouldn't, in like the first 2 minutes, I was like, hold on, this is not going right. We need to change something here. So, you know, those words are a good indicator that, okay, this is not the right mindset.
Okay. So has there been any instance like you are having a positive mood and talking to a client, it has sort of shifted your mindset or your mood? I won't say mindset. I would say your mood towards a different sort of a conversation. Has it have a negative impact on you? And how do you deal with that sort of an energy?
It does. It does. Because there are certain people, a lot of times when you're doing coaching and there are certain people, they're not able to look at any options. So very recently I was coaching somebody and she was just not able to look at any options. And it was like, it's not my fault. It's the other person's fault. Even when you're trying to, you know, help her gently take into a different direction, she was just like, it's everything about the other person. So it frustrates you. It dampens your mood as well. But then I guess, you know, I'm a pranic healer as well. So I've done pranic healing as well. So one needs to know when to cut that cord. So after some of these sessions, I ensure that I'm cutting that cord. That emotional cord, because otherwise, you know, it's very difficult.
Okay, so it's good to know that even you people are quite human to these things, because people have this conception that, yeah, people have this conception that she's a coach, she is like indifferent to these things. These things don't affect her. She's there for the positive vibe or to like improve your lifestyle.
That's such a misconception. We are humans at the end of the day. We feel bad. We feel exhausted, frustrations, irritations. Yeah, it's just that the ability to understand our own emotions is possibly higher. We are more mindful. So if in this conversation with you, I get irritated, I know that, you know, there's a trigger point. I know how to control it. But yeah, I do get triggered. It's just that my ability to control and not react is possibly better than someone else. Possibly that also. I won't say that is better.
So I believe that a person definitely affects their atmosphere as well. So do you think like the sort of calm and positive vibe that you have is also reflected on your children? Like you can understand what mindset they are going through and you can guide them along the way. So has that affected them as well?
So they're very young. But yeah, I think it has to some extent. I have, as I said, I have two boys, and one of them is 10 and one of them is 8. I think the older one, obviously, I see him making the right choices. I see him. It's possibly also age, but then I do see looking at things like, you know, very recently, we were just talking about something. He said, "Mom, why don't you look at it positively? Why are you only looking at, you know, what you've lost?" Mm-hmm. And both me and my husband was like, okay, so that's like a 10-year-old teaching us about positive mindset and looking at things positively. So, you know, those are good reminders. As I said, even we are humans, it gets to us, but obviously the children are picking it up. So it's nice.
So I believe it's one of those pat on the back sort of a movement where you, like, moment where you are like having that conversation with your children. And even a 10-year-old, even I was thinking the same thing, like a 10-year-old is telling her mother, like his mother, he like, you should try to look at the positive aspect.
Oh yes, in fact he took a session on growth mindset in his class and I was like, wow. And he told me, okay, after the entire thing was over, he said, "Mom, you know, I had heard your video the other day, the one that you had recorded." Mm-hmm. And so ma'am was asking about something. So I did a quick 5-minute session with everybody telling them what a growth mindset is. I'm like, okay, that's interesting. So yeah, the children are picking it up and it's good. Yeah, it's a pat on the back. It's nice.
Okay, so I think next session I'll have to book it with you. I think with him as well. Because since he's doing it since a long time, so I think I can get in touch with him. Anyway, so going back to the topic, I wanted to ask about, like, do you think being authentic is important when you are having a growth mindset? Like, is it important to be yourself or is it more important to have that positive energy around you?
It, you know, it's, as we say, practice makes a man perfect. When you start understanding that there's a certain way in which you need to deal with what's happening to you, over a period of time, it just becomes a way of life. So over a period of time, I don't have to sit in front of you and pretend to be positive or pretend to be, haha, hee hee, I'm very happy and I do not need to use negative words. It just comes automatically to me. Over a period of time, that's authentic. So, you know, when a person, like, there was this one gentleman I used to work with about 4 or 5 years back, and he was very short-tempered. And while he was the CEO of a firm, he would walk in with, like, face down, body closed, just walk straight to the cabin, lose his temper at the smallest thing. And I remember speaking to him about, you know, why do you do? He said, "This is the way I am. People need to accept me the way I am." And we did a 1-year coaching thing with him. And I also got him in touch with a few people to speak to who mentored him. And he was a CEO, a young CEO, about 33 years of age. And thereafter, we saw marked change, because when you're coaching, when you coach somebody, it, you know, those nuances of, oh, this is triggering me, this affects me, this is what makes me annoyed. I think once you start realizing those, you are immediately, as I said, you know, it becomes very easy to make that connect and change yourself. It's like in a snap of a moment, you know, oh, okay, I'm getting angry, getting irritated, or I'm not delegating right, or I'm not communicating right, whatever you're coaching someone on, you know, coaching is about behaviors. So the moment you're able to identify that, and you're able to make that change, and, you know, it's a behavioral change that will happen over a period of time, then it becomes a way of life. So then that's the new authentic. I don't know if that answers your question.
No, it does. I do like that line where you say that the guy said that people should accept him the way it is. It's often confused with the term authentic. Being authentic and trying not to work on your flaws is something entirely different. These are two different things. People tend to mix them up and they're like, I'm being myself, and people should accept or respect that choice. And I would say that even I'm guilty of using those lines at times. But that's a very nice thing to know, that even I had, so he's the 8-year-old one, I believe.
Yeah, he is. So sorry about that.
No, it's completely fine. So as we were going back, so I wanted to talk about more about the, like, we know that how the world is changing now and lockdown is impacting people. Most of the people are either working from home. So if they are, they're more glued to technology. Like, you would see that mothers or even grandparents nowadays are glued to their phones, and everybody in the house is together on a dining table, but with their own cell phones or with their own equipment of technology. So how would you say, what can we do at this sort of an environment to bring about a positive change or a sense of well-being, or I would say a sense of belonging in such an atmosphere?
So, you know, what we did at home, and each house is different. So I can only tell you what we did and maybe give a few suggestions as well. I think people should have a schedule in the house. Specific time where, say for example, you wake up in the morning and a couple of hours or maybe an hour where the family sits together, whether it's for tea or it's for breakfast or whatever. And then like, we continued our schedule exactly how it was. So 9 o'clock work starts for everybody in the house. All four of us, we are on our laptops working. It's normal day, then it's a routine. We take a break at an exact time, 1 to 2, all of us have lunch together. And then there's an evening tea again for about half an hour, because then it's work time for everybody. So there's half an hour, and then dinner together. I think that also ensures that, one, we are getting time together as a family, because if, I think COVID has forced everyone together. And even in this time, if you're all on our technology more than anything else, then we are not utilizing this proud moment, or I think, proud is the wrong time, but I think this opportune time to spend time with the family, I think we'll miss out on that. I also have very specific time for the family to spend on random things on their mobiles. So for example, after 9, there is nothing which is related to digital at all. So before we all sleep, about a couple of hours before that, we don't use any electronics. I think to create that positivity, we need to ensure that there's that schedule. Obviously, it's difficult because all of us are now addicted. It's like, you know, if I have to read the newspaper, I'll pick up the phone. And once you pick up the phone for, say, even to read the newspaper, you'll then go to Facebook, and then you'll go to, you know, 50 different social medias. I think the point is, we need to understand, and that's also about that mindfulness and awareness that I've been talking about. I think it's that awareness that you are possibly doing spending far more time. Mm-hmm. How much time are you spending on electronics? And just if you keep that schedule, it just helps.
Okay, so talking about the growth mindset, people have this analogy that growth mindset and winning mindset are the same thing. So do you think they are same? Because I remember watching this documentary recently. It was about a basketball player. So the name is Last Dance. So what he has is that, I have to win. There is a specific quote that he says, which I think reflects his ideology well. He says that there is no I in the team, but there is an I in win. So that's sort of an analogy this person has, though I admire him deeply. But later on, he does change, like, you can win titles by like alone, but you do need a team for winning a championship. But I wanted to know, reflect back on the previous quote that I had said, like, do you think that this person is having a growth mindset, or is it more of a winning mindset, or they are somewhat similar?
Growth might, see, as I said a little while back, we can use whatever adjective we want to. Mm-hmm. As long as the purpose is that we are going together, it's not just about me doing what I need to do to make it a success. It's also about me taking everybody along with me to make it a success. You know, we were talking about mentors a little while back. Unless I had not, if I did not have the mentors at various points in time, which I had, I wouldn't have been where I am today. So somebody gave me that push, which means we all need to work together. And that is what a good mindset or a growth mindset or winning, whichever, I mean, as I said, you know, you call it whatever name, adjective you want to. The point is, we need to have the mindset where we are reaching out to others, we're helping others. We are working with others, because, you know, one is the Indian concept of karma, you give what you get. But also, I think it's far more important that we need to understand that energies come together to create something. So when two people come together, they and they have complementary skills, they're able to help each other. And when you have a group working together, and which is what we also speak when we're talking about inclusion, when you have a group working together, different ideas come together, different ideologies come together, and then when these ideologies together create something concrete, that is what takes us from point A to point B. So working together is, I think teamwork is a unique ability that people need to have. People need to see how to bind that. There is no fun in raging the war alone.
Mm-hmm. So yeah, they do say that if you want to go like fast, then you should go alone. But if you want to go far, you should go with a team. Or
absolutely. Your I think collection of quotes is very, very good. But yeah, this is really true.
Thank you so much. Actually, that's what you get when you are on social media a lot. You get to see quotes. They are like positive ones, negative ones, and they are like daily quotes of the day. So I have all of them stored in my mind, though I would not say that I'm following each and every one of them religiously. But I do try, like whenever I'm feeling down, I'll think of something that comes to my mind. So I wanted to know, what for you is that? Like if you're feeling down, would you read a book or would you refer to something that someone has taught you, or who is that person that you would go to?
As I said, I've had different mentors. So for going at various points in time, I have to all of these people, to express my thoughts. And I'm a compulsive thinker. I continuously think. So obviously a compulsive thinker needs somebody where you can just, go and vent it out.
Mm-hmm.
But when I'm really feeling down, I like to pen down my thoughts. Mm-hmm. I think there's a huge power in writing your thoughts. And there's a reason why when we were growing up, there was emphasis on writing notes at school and in the education field. I don't see that anymore. And especially because of COVID, I don't see the importance on writing, especially with children. But I think there's a huge power in writing. When you write it down, most of us are visual people. So when you write it down, when you're able to just express it in words, it really helps us get clarity about what the thought process is like, where mm-hmm. we are going from point A to point B, what is the mind thinking. A lot of times, and people like me, compulsive thinkers who think a lot, they'll be driving and they'll be thinking. So they'll be, on a Zoom call, and there's like a second chain of thought going somewhere else. And I always say this to my coaches also. Keep a pen and a paper handy at all points in time. Whatever is the thought that comes to your mind, you need to write it down. You need to jot that thought down and see why are you thinking what you're thinking. It's very important to understand, why am I bogged down right now? What is troubling me? What can I do differently? What can I do to get me out of this mindset? What can I do to... And when we were talking about opportunities a little while back, I think that writing also gives you different opportunities. When you start writing, you'll suddenly be like, oh, I have written this down. Because otherwise, thought thinking and just that thought process, it exhausts the brain. You will, what we do is usually, acha, this has happened, and then maybe that will happen, and maybe that will happen. And so your brain is exhausted. By the time the actual event hits you, your brain is so exhausted, you're unable to do anything about it. Mm-hmm. Writing it down actually gives a proper chain, line, thought process. You're able to properly, in a very structured way, reflect it. So I have an Excel sheet which I maintain. I also have a journal which I maintain, which is incidentally right here. So I write my thoughts extensively. In fact, I make flowcharts for my thoughts. I'm letting you in on a secret.
So I'll definitely try that thing. I haven't heard about like making a flowchart. For science projects we have, like even for memorizing things, we have made flowcharts. But that's something really cool that I've heard, and I'll definitely try doing that. Actually, I myself am trying to write more, because I am listening to different podcasts and all. They say that writing crystallizes your thoughts, and it also refines them in a very good way. If you're having an irrational thought, so if you write it down on a piece of paper and read it once, you'll feel that, that's stupid. Just like someone else tells you their insecurities and you're like, no, that's not true. But if that someone is you, then you need someone else to tell you that. So I believe that writing completely does that for you.
Yeah, I mean, that's why we need coaches, right? A coach is able to give you a different perspective. A mentor is able to give you a different perspective. When you're speaking with leaders, for example, I think it's very lonely at the top. When you're speaking with somebody who with, say, 15 years of experience or 20, 25 years of experience, sitting at the C-level somewhere, heading a business somewhere, those positions are very lonely. You cannot speak to your peer or team and get perspectives. I think in those positions, it becomes very important that either you have a coach who can help you get that different perspective or write it down. I think that exactly how you said, you know, you need that different perspective. You need that third person's view, because when you're inside something, inside the fence, it's very difficult to look at things objectively. When you start writing, you can kind of sit, be outside the fence, look at the situation from outside, see, oh, this is what it is. I need to possibly do something differently, and that really helps.
Absolutely, I believe in that as well. Now I wanted to ask more about the fact that people do write, like majority of the people I've heard, like good, amazing speakers, they believe that writing down their thoughts is a very good way of doing that. And you also mentioned that being at the top is sort of lonely, and you are someone who mentors these people. So what are your greatest learnings? Because I'm pretty sure that looking at them, you will be able to learn from their mistakes as well as whatever things that they are doing right. Like, for example, even in this session, I'm learning a lot of things like flowchart. I'll definitely try to incorporate that. So what are your learnings? Like three biggest learnings that you had with your clients?
You know, let me start by one. I think as we are, when we are growing up, you look at people who are sitting in these big positions and you think that your parents or these people in big positions, you know, the some CEO, some your immediate supervisor, you think they're all perfect. Or you think that, oh, they know all the answers. Or you think that once you reach their position, you would have all answers. I think my biggest learning was that irrespective of the position one is in, irrespective of whatever one has achieved, I think everybody has insecurities. Everybody has moments where people are down. Everybody who's a public speaker, most of them will have shaking knees when they stand in front of 100 people and they start talking. So if you go and you feel that, oh, I cannot speak in front of 100 people, trust me, the biggest speaker has gone through those moments. If you think that somebody sitting in those big positions have not had moments where he's had self-doubt, where he's thought that I'm not good enough for this role, where he's had imposter syndrome, everybody has it. I am yet to find someone who thinks, oh, I've got this role and I'm perfect for it. Everybody has moments of doubt. I think that has been my first learning, which gave me a lot of confidence. Because when you start realizing that you're not alone in this, it just makes you look at things very differently. The second point is that, and this is something that I have had a lot of people tell me, Shruti, when we sit in meetings or when we are sitting in a group, we are very quiet. And I said, why are you quiet? They're like, oh, we have nothing new to offer. Everyone is already talking. There's nothing new to offer. And I think what I have mostly, I think my point is each one of us has one thing to offer but which nobody has, which is our personal experience. My life is my life. My experiences are mine, which nobody else has had then. My thought processes, my perspectives, that is unique to me. So in whatever situation you are in, if you feel, and this is a generic you, I think in whatever situation one is, if one feels that I have nothing distinct to offer, the biggest distinct, biggest unique thing we all have to offer are our life experiences that nobody else can replicate. I think if we know this, that fear of talking, that fear of influencing for leaders, the fear of reaching out to people, for speakers when they go and speak in front of 100, I think all of that will go away. And the third thing is, I think just being humble and just give. Just give and give and give. And if you can add value to even one life, every day in whatever way, I think the peace with which one sleeps at you know, when the day ends is immense. I don't know if that answers your question, but I think those have been my learnings when through my coaching, through my interaction, and now I think I interact with so many people. I think those have been the learnings that but yeah, I mean, not that I am the best in this. I'm sure there are others who would have different as well.
Yeah, so that is the growth mindset that I'm seeing in you. Like you're saying that I'm not the best, but I'm still learning. So I believe there are small anecdotes that you can get from a person. Even if he's saying a small thing, you can get things out of it. I do believe that the learnings that you have are quite good. I would say that they are enriching for someone who hasn't experienced it herself. I would not say that. I believe that whenever you are like you read about good things or you read about posts or quotes, these things, they impact you. But until and unless you have experienced it yourself, you won't be able to feel the complete impact of that thing. Like, for example, I would say that I'm someone who's not comfortable talking with a lot of people or even with a stranger. If I'm sitting next to someone, I would not be the one who would start a conversation with them. So because I'll have that fear, like, what if he thinks, like, well, that's weird. Like, why do you want to talk to me? You don't know me. And we have that stranger syndrome that our parents have inculcated in us, that don't talk to a stranger, don't share food, don't do this. So I believe that somewhat restricts you. I won't say that that's a negative thing. That's a parent trying to protect her child. That's completely all right. But I do believe that these things are there. So one of the quotes, again, coming back to the quotes that I would say, quotes or lines I would say is that they say that whatever you are doing, it's okay. You can go ahead and do that thing. But remember that if it's not something that people are going to remember for years, then it's okay. You can make mistakes in that. It's completely fine with that. And I do believe, and I strongly believe in this quote, that like whenever I took up public speaking in class 7th, I believe, and I was standing there horrified. I had no words to speak because there was like a big crowd of people who are waiting for this thing to get over. Like usually children sit around and they're just waiting once the speaker is done and they'll just we'll go home. So I was like horrified to stand there and just not say anything. And I remember once I was done, like I just said, good morning, this is my topic, and I went off, thank you. And the loudest claps were for my speech, and that was because I ended in the shortest duration possible, not because like they were trying to encourage me or something. But I tried to take it that way, like it's okay, I'll try. And now that I think about it, I feel that nobody remembers that. I do. And from that person to this person, I believe that I have grown a little, I would say. Because saying that I've grown a lot would be sort of like boasting, I would say. But yeah. So I am trying to grow in that aspect. What about you? Like, how has your mindset changed from the time you were a child to the time that you have become a coach, mother, and all these journeys that you have?
I think we all have different mindsets at different point in time. It was very interesting when I was hearing your story about mistakes. I was like, it's interesting, right? We all fear making those mistakes. We all fear, what if someone will laugh? What will people think? What if I make a mistake? I've had the pleasure of, and I have to mention it here, I've had the pleasure of working with someone who once told me that, Shruti, go out there, make mistakes. I'll be there to back you. And that has been a very big booster. But coming back to your point, what has been the mindset? I think different mindset at different points in time. Obviously, when we lose somebody, I lost my father at a very young age. Obviously, the mindset is very, very different. When you have those minor successes, the mindset is very different. So I think even in a day, sometimes the mindset moves from a high to a low. And as I was saying, you know, it's a constant need to just keep reminding yourself, Shruti, you're possibly not in the right frame of mind. You possibly need to take a break right now. Take a 5-minute break, get yourself, collect yourself, and then move forward. So even in a day, I think all of us, and it's not just me, I'll be wrong to say that it's me. I think all of us move between being in a great mindset to being in a fixed mindset. And then it's a question of just whether we're able to take control and then move on and remind ourselves. And which is why we need these journals and writing and perspectives. And, you know, I think even a coach needs a coach. So, yeah, it's That's how it
is. So have you started some sort of a gratitude journal or like a gratitude jar where you're writing things that you're grateful for?
Oh, yes. I have a gratitude journal. I have a journal in which I write about all the high points in life. Why do I consider them to be high points, and what has been my learning? I also write a journal on what are the low points in life, and what are my learnings? Why do I consider them low? What was the emotion associated with whether it's a high point or a low point? Which helps me understand my own mindset and how do I, you know, to understand the trigger points and how do you get out of those. So while I do the gratitude journal on a daily basis, the highs and lows are usually done once in a month, just to understand, okay, unless there is something which is really major that has happened, for me to sit down, okay, I think it's important for us to understand what are the emotions we are going through. So even when I coach, my point is, you know, say for example, if I'm sitting with you, I'd be like, okay, tell me 5 emotions you're feeling right now, and exactly 5, not more than that. Mm-hmm. And why do you feel those emotions? What is it that you're feeling? Can you identify those emotions? Can you write those emotions? I think that really helps.
So for me personally, I have seen that that does help. Like for example, you are feeling hurt, but most of the times that cannot be hurt. Like there is a reason for that happening. There might be an underlying anger, or you're not able to understand that emotion until unless you are analyzing it or introspecting it. So lastly, I would say thank you so much for having me. Thank you so much for being here. I do believe that you are having this sort of intimidating impact on me.
Ouch. So. That wasn't the intention. I am so sorry.
No, it's okay. I would say to have someone who has coached so many people and I'm having a conversation with her, I am taking her interview of the HR person. So that's somewhat.
I am not an HR person. My past life is HR. Yes, I do consult on HR. But I keep telling people, don't call me an HR person. I think I'm, at best, I'm a people's person. Yes. I love interacting with people, yes. But, you know, when you say someone is an HR person, you're just kind of boxing the person into a very corporate role. So, yeah, I'm a people's person. I love being with people. I love talking to people. I love holding hands. If I can only be a patch to the many people who've mentored me and guided me, if I can create even a patch of the goodwill they've all had, I believe I will be successful. So.
Yeah, that's a lovely thought. Like, I do believe in karma. I do believe that when you're doing something good for someone, even if it does not come back to you, that sense of satisfaction will come. And that's something that's major for me. Like, you'll feel satisfied. You'll feel that you have made an impact in the world and that you have a purpose, for example, I'd say. So thank you so much for being here. I think I'm doing this right this time. So thank you so much. And
thank you.
You have shared a lot of good things with me. From maintaining a journal to writing down your thoughts, making sure that you are introspecting on things and trying to manage everything and having a family and trying to spend time with them as well. And lastly, I would thank you for being here, even after what I've heard recently. So I would say thank you so much. It takes immense courage to have a conversation. And I can say that your coach or your mentor has mentored you well to be here and to give that sort of a encouraging and inspiring talk to everyone.
Yeah, I mean, as I said, I wouldn't be doing justice to him if I would have cancelled this. he would have wanted life to go on. So this is just my way of a tribute to him. So thank you for having me here.
Welcome. I'm pretty sure he is proud of you.
Thank you, Deepthi. So thanks a ton. Thanks for Mitti Kiran for having me here.
Thank you. Have a nice day.
Thanks.